Hello, doctor. What's your name?
I'm Dr. John Wang. I'm a vascular surgeon with Pan-Asia Surgery and Advanced Vascular and Endovascular Clinic.
What does a vascular and endovascular surgeon do?
I operate on patients. I'm just kidding. I'm more of a human plumber. I treat patients with vascular disease, such as aneurysms in their aorta or peripheral arteries, or blockages in their blood supply where they need a surgical bypass or treatment with balloon angioplasty or stents. I also operate on patients with bothersome varicose veins in their legs. Now you may wonder, what is a vascular surgeon doing in treating high blood pressure? Because most of the time, high blood pressure is managed by our medical specialty colleagues such as GPs, internists, cardiologists, and nephrologists. Well, let's find out how I can help.
What is hypertension?
Let's start off with what is normal blood pressure. Normal blood pressure is defined as a blood pressure of 120 over 80 millimeters mercury. The top number has a range between 100 to 120, and the bottom range, which is the diastolic blood pressure, should be between 60 and 80 millimeters mercury. Now, in 2003, the JNC, or Joint National Commission for Management of High Blood Pressure, in 2003 defined high blood pressure as anything above 140 over 90 millimeters mercury. Mind you, in 2017, this has been revised by the ACC and AHA, which is the American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. Blood pressure above 130 over 80 millimeters mercury is now considered high blood pressure. There is also refractory hypertension, of which high blood pressure is seen despite the patients being on three different medications, which is distinctly different from uncontrolled hypertension, where the patient is not or inadequately treated with medications.
Why do people develop hypertension? What's it caused by?
The majority of people who develop hypertension or high blood pressure are known as essential hypertension. Basically, we don't know why, but it is known to be associated with older age, male sex, sedentary or lack of exercise, obesity, and other unhealthy habits such as smoking. And other medical conditions can contribute to patients getting high blood pressure too, such as diabetes, high cholesterol, and kidney disease. There is a secondary hypertension condition of which there is an underlying cause, such as adrenal gland tumors or renal artery stenosis, where the kidney arteries are narrowed and the kidneys are underperfused.
Oh no, I'm a guy. How do I know if I have hypertension? What are the most common symptoms?
Most of the time, and most of the time means 80% of the time, patients have no symptoms whatsoever. And that's why it's dangerous. You don't even know you have it. So the only way you will know if you have high blood pressure is if you actually slap on the blood pressure cuff and have the machine measure your blood pressure for you. If high blood pressure is going to give you symptoms, commonly these symptoms include headaches, dizziness, shortness of breath, heaviness in the chest, or sometimes patients can actually present with acute shortness of breath. Now, some symptoms are worrisome and may indicate that some bad things are going on. For example, persistent chest pain may tell us that the patient may be having a heart attack, or if there is persistent pain from the chest straight back to your spine, there is a condition called aortic dissection, which is associated with very, very high blood pressures. Some of the times patients can present with acute shortness of breath, where it's called flash pulmonary edema, where the lungs get waterlogged. And also, don't forget, patients can sometimes present with numbness on one side of the body or paralysis or slurring of the speech, which we will be concerned about whether the patient is having a stroke because of high blood pressure.
Well, that sounds like symptoms like older guys get, but what is the youngest or oldest patient you've ever treated?
Now, high blood pressure doesn't necessarily discriminate because some of the youngest patients that I've treated are in their 30s. And the oldest patients I've seen and have been involved with treatment are nonagenarians. They are well into their 90s.
No way. So can hypertension be cured? Is there any treatment for it?
Now, unfortunately, there are no food or fruits that you can eat to prevent it or even treat it. But most of the time, we can actually manage it with medical therapy. What we do is we start the patients on one agent, and we increase the dosage such that the effect is achieved, meaning to bring the blood pressure towards 130 over 80. If the dosage of the first agent is maxed out, then we may have to add a second agent and keep upping the dose. Sometimes we need a third or maybe a fourth agent, such that the goal of therapy is to bring the blood pressure closer to 130/80.
So like there are all these agents, like there's the blue pill, yellow pill, white pill, what are they for?
Coloration of the pills are basically for the patients to discriminate between the different types of medications that they may actually be on. Now, just because a fire engine is a red in color in terms of the truck, it doesn't mean that all red trucks are fire engines. And for that matter, the coloration is actually completely arbitrary and it's up to the pharmaceutical companies to codify them. What's most important is for the patients to know what type of medication they're on, their dosage, and the frequency of which they're supposed to take it every single day.
With so many medications, dosage like that, what is the downside of taking so many?
Well, for one, all medications have side effects, especially if you increase the dosage. Secondly, when patients are on many medications, which is polypharmacy, time and time again, it's been shown that the patients can get confused, and that leads to poor compliance. The combination of undesirable side effects and also polypharmacy essentially leads to poor medical therapy, poor medical compliance, and also increased complications, all of which we're trying to prevent.
Scary stuff, Doc. What kind of side effects?
Well, medications like beta blockers not only decrease the heart rate and contractility of the heart, but it also can depress the mood of the patient and mentation. Long-term use of diuretics can cause cramps in patients' legs and also can lead to kidney impairment. Other medications can cause things like headaches, they can cause dry coughs, and even erectile dysfunction.
Well, obviously I wouldn't want any of that, but like if I don't take my medication for like a long time, if I put them off, what are the long-term effects of poorly controlled hypertension?
Well, about 30 to 40% of patients who have high blood pressure don't really take their medications like they're supposed to. So there is a real gap between prescribed therapy and actual medical efficacy in that sense to prevent complications such as heart attacks, heart failure, stroke, or kidney failure and peripheral arterial disease. These complications, if they occur, can be severely debilitating to patients and it can even be fatal. Not to mention it will surely add on to the healthcare cost of the patients.
But are there any alternatives to just taking all these medications?
Now, thankfully, most patients can be managed medically and most will be medically compliant, and the goal of therapy can be reached to prevent all these bad complications. There is a subset of patients, however, with refractory hypertension that we can particularly treat and help. These are the patients who are hypertensive despite being on three different medications or more. And this is called renal denervation therapy, which a vascular surgeon like myself can offer the patients. It can bring down the blood pressure by 5 to 10 points in a sustained fashion, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and beyond.
Doctor, what is renal denervation?
Renal denervation therapy is very similar to a coronary angiogram, where the kidney or the renal arteries of the patients are accessed, and using a very specialized catheter, very accurate amounts of radio frequency energy is delivered to the arteries and the network of nerves surrounding them, disrupting the nerve pathways. Now we know normally that the sympathetic nerves communicate with the heart, the carotid arteries, and also the brain to regulate blood pressure. In patients with high blood pressure, disrupting these nerves using RDN or renal denervation can bring down the blood pressure successfully and succinctly, such that it is a sustained benefit.
Sounds dangerous. How do you know if renal denervation is suitable for a patient?
RDN is actually CE marked in Europe and FDA in the US approved for treatment of refractory hypertension. So meaning that it is very, very safe. To know if you're a candidate for RDN therapy, give our clinic a call and we will schedule you an appointment so that we can do a thorough assessment for you and explain the eligibility criteria to you.